Pleasure tonight to introduce Dr. Shane Brie. And he currently is diagnostic and interventional radiologist and MRI section chief here on the south end of the island. His topic for tonight is New Frontiers in Prostate Cancer Detection and Evaluation. And he asks the question, poses it over there, is MRI a game changer? So we'll find that out when he talks to us. A little bit about his background. He has an undergraduate degree in electrical engineering and physics at Queen's University. He completed a PhD jointly between electrical and computer engineering and biotechnology at the Michael Smith Lab at the University of Vancouver. And the University of BC in Vancouver. He completed his internship and his residency at UBC before completing fellowships in vascular and interventional radiology at the University of Colorado and cardiac MRI at the University of Calgary. It's one heck of a lot of education. Amazing. Since 2008, he's been a staff radiologist and held a variety of positions in the Department of Medical Imaging at the Island Health here in Victoria. He tells me he moves between the hospitals here at the lower end of the island. He's currently organizing a prostate cancer imaging symposium here in the province of the BC radiologist. His personal interests include prostate MRI and biopsy. And in his leisure time, if he has any, he enjoys sailing in the beautiful waters of the Pacific Northwest. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Shane Brie.
Thanks a lot, Nolan. Thank you very much, everyone, for inviting me here. I feel very privileged, actually, to get a chance to talk to everybody. I was saying earlier that I give a lot of talks, and a lot of talks about prostate cancer and prostate MRI, but they're almost universally to physicians and occasionally nurses and technologists. I've never given a talk to a group of patients, which I think is, I was really remiss about it, but I have to say it's actually very intimidating. It's much more intimidating than speaking to a room full of experts. It's very, very difficult. But I do have a passion for prostate MRI and developing programs in prostate MRI. And we started our program here a couple of years ago. And you couldn't really do special training in prostate MRI because it didn't really exist for a couple of years. So it's a very exciting new field. And the question about is it a game changer, it really is for certain people, and I'll tell you why in a moment. So unfortunately, some aspects of MRI can be a bit dry, and I'm going to try to avoid all that. I don't want to talk about a lot of technical things and show you a bunch of pictures of disease. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about why it's important and what it means to whom. I think this seems like a really educated audience, so you probably already know that prostate cancer is a very common disease. It affects around 1 in 7 men. But a lot of that is disease that you might make even worse by treating it, where some of that is disease that's a bad player and you want to treat that. And the idea with prostate MRI is to, well, there are several different ideas. One is to separate those two things out. I'll talk a little bit more about what prostate MRI can do. So, this is Panacea. Panacea is the Greek goddess of universal remedy, the solution to all problems, the cure. And many people think certain tests, like MRI, is the absolute magic bullet, figures everything out. But as you probably already are aware, there is no magic bullet. But it is a very important test with a lot of very useful information. I wonder if I could get a show of hands, how many people in here have had a prostate MRI? Has anyone had one of the new biopsies that we do with the MRI and the ultrasound together?
One where they go inside you and keep taking and they're watching it on a screen?
That's right, yeah.
Yeah, I was your first one.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, that's
okay. So that's something we're starting. I'll tell you about that shortly. So I don't know if anyone here has heard about Ben Stiller's experience.
Yeah.
He was, you know, there's a lot of people get prostate cancer, but you know, when a famous person gets prostate cancer, it's a big deal. So he had an interview on the Today Show, and he talked a lot about the PSA test. But the PSA test is very, very important, although, as you probably know, it's controversial, and there are different guidelines in the US and Canada and in Europe. He talked a lot about the PSA test, but if you actually go over the process that he went through, he had the PSA test, which was elevated, and they followed it. And then they did an MRI, which actually found the cancer. And that's what led to, that allowed them to target that and to biopsy. More recently, and you probably haven't heard this, but just last month, there was a big study that came out of England that showed exactly how useful MRI is for new patients with prostate cancer or suspected prostate cancer. I would say the old, but actually the current way of working this up is you go to your family, as you all know, probably better than I do, you go to your family doctor, have a digital rectal exam where they try to feel a spot on your prostate. Might do a PSA test, although again that's controversial, that might be elevated. So they might feel something in your prostate, your PSA might be elevated, and then typically you would go for a biopsy of your prostate, a blind biopsy, where they take a whole bunch of biopsies all over the gland. And I will tell you this, there is no other gland in the human body that we randomly biopsy looking for cancer. The prostate is the only gland we do that. Don't do it in the liver, we don't do it in the breast, don't do it in the brain, we don't do it in the colon. Every other organ in the body, you find the cancer first, and then you biopsy. Prostate, for some reason, is different, and we're hoping to change that. That's why. And that's what this recent study that we've been trying to prove for a long time has shown. That if we look in a patient who has a suspicion of prostate cancer, so a PSA test is up, or there's something on the digital rectal exam, if we look with MRI first and then biopsy, it's more useful than the current way we're doing. And this is in flux, it's not something that's going to change today, but it will change. And that's one of the key reasons MRI will be useful. So this is the perfect test. You know, you have a binocular microscope, you look at it, it's obviously a mammoth, it's a mammoth. And that's what we want in any medical test. We look at it, and it looks like prostate cancer, it is, we call it prostate cancer, it's always prostate cancer. Or we look, we don't see prostate cancer, we say there's no prostate cancer, and we're always right. Unfortunately, that's not always the case. No test is perfect. So, that was just a little introduction of why prostate cancer is sort of an up-and-coming test. Now, what can it be used for? It can be used for more than what I just said. So, this is what I just went over. Prostate MRI is a radiology test to help find significant cancer in patients at increased risk. They have a physical finding on the digital rectal exam or an elevated PSA. It's not perfect, but it's a substantial improvement. And it's not for everybody. Only really benefits certain people. It can also be used to guide a biopsy. So after we find this spot on an MRI, we can then direct a biopsy at it instead of randomly sampling, like I said, the only organ in the human body doctors randomly biopsy. It can also be used to see how far prostate cancer has spread. So if you have a diagnosis of prostate cancer, and there was a question about this earlier this evening, but if you have a diagnosis of prostate cancer, the prostate cancer can be confined to inside the prostate, or it can spread locally outside of it into some adjacent structures, into different parts of the pelvis, into your seminal vesicles, into your bladder, into lymph nodes in that area. And MRI is very good for looking at that. And that will help the urologists and the oncologist decide how to treat it. It can also be used to monitor disease progression. Some people get prostate cancer, and again, there are a variety of prostate cancers. I think you're all familiar with the Gleason score, which goes from 6 to 10, basically, currently. It used to go lower, but right now it goes from 6 to 10. And sixes and certain sevens, you probably don't want to treat right away. And you can do what's called watchful waiting or active surveillance. Has anyone heard of that? Just a show of hands. Yeah, so watchful waiting or active surveillance. And that means different things to different people, and in different places it means different things. But often it means recognizing that you have a low-grade prostate cancer and watching for something to happen, be it a change on the digital rectal exam, you feel something, a change in the PSA test, or repeating a biopsy and having a change in the Gleason score, and repeating that periodically, and then only treating it if there's a significant change. MRI, in the future, hopefully, I shouldn't say in the future, it's currently used for this, but it's developing, will be maybe a better thing to use in watchful waiting. It's not for everyone right now, but with MRI, you have a low-grade cancer, you don't want to treat it because it might not go anywhere. You watch it with MRI, and if it starts growing, that's a sign to treat it, for example. And in the future, this is something else that may be used to guide treatment. It's already used to guide treatment a little bit with radiation therapy, but I'll talk about this a little bit in a minute. How in the future, knowing exactly where the prostate gland the cancer is will be useful to guide the exact therapy. Okay. I thought about this and I wondered if I should explain, try to get through what magnetic resonance imaging or MRI actually is. And I thought it actually might be somewhat useful, and it was a bit of a challenge to me because you spend years and years learning about it, and it's hard to present in 5 minutes to give someone a flavor for what it is, but I decided I'd give it a shot. So what is MRI, or magnetic resonance? It stands for magnetic resonance imaging. For prostate, occasionally you see it called MP-MRI, which means multi-parametric MRI, but it's just the same. It's just magnetic resonance imaging. So how does it work? Basically, MRI looks like water in your body, and a little bit fat, and a little bit protein, a few other things, mostly they're protons, but we'll call it water. We're looking at water, and it'll tell us how much water is there, and what's around the water, or fat. And it turns out that different amounts of water are present in disease as compared to normal tissue, and the water is in next to different things, and it'll give a different signal. So a powerful magnetic field stretches the water molecules out, or the fat molecules. And then we hit the water with basically an FM radio. We stretch it out with a magnetic field, we hit it with an FM radio, and then the water rings. And we listen for the ring, and we can tell where that's coming from. So anyone who's been in an MRI knows it's like a big donut. And you slide in there. And this will make more sense in a minute. But there's a big donut there. There's a superconducting magnet, and there's a big magnetic field in there. And then there's some other things, these radiant coils, and a radio frequency coil, which is just an FM radio. So, this is the dry stuff that's not going to make a lot of sense, but I'm going to try to explain in a minute how it works. So, I thought about this, and I thought about how to explain it, about what would make the most sense. So, imagine you have a piano. If you have the piano strings, and you don't stretch them, they're under tension. If you hit them, they won't make any sound. They won't ring. But we stretch all the piano strings out, and they're all stretched at a different amount of tension. And then you have the hammer that comes down and hits the piano string. And then you hear it. And then imagine you are a blind, very accomplished piano player, like Ray Charles. So you have the piano, you have all the strings stretched, you hit them, and you listen for them. If you're Ray Charles, or the computer attached to the MRI, you can tell exactly where on the key it was hit. So it's the same thing with MRI. So we stretch the water molecules out. We stretch them out different amounts depending on where they are. We hit them with a hammer, which is just an FM radio. They ring, and then the computer listens to them and figures out where it is. That's actually exactly what MRI is. So you're in this big donut. The donut produces the magnetic field. There's another antenna in the donut, which produces FM radio signal. It actually is the same as FM radio. And the FM radio signal goes into your body, makes the prostate cancer ring, and depending on where it is, it will ring at a different frequency, and then our electronic Ray Charles tells us where it is in the gland. So we have to listen. We have to listen for the ring. So what's the ear? The ear is what we call a coil. So there's two different types of coil for prostate MRI that you will hear about if you look into it. One is an endorectal coil. So this is just an antenna. It's an FM radio antenna that goes up your behind because it's close to your prostate. And the antenna listens for that ring. We actually don't do this. Instead, what we do is we use a surface coil. So this is just another FM radio coil, an FM radio antenna. You go inside the magnet stretches the prostate cancer water molecules out. You bang them with an FM radio, they ring, and then we hear them with this FM antenna, which just sits on the body. So what does that do? Actually, before we talk about that, you may hear, and I want to explain this to people, that there are different types of MRI. Different number of Teslas, different, it's actually a magnetic field strength. And you'll hear that here in the city of Victoria because there's a 3 Tesla magnet that's a private magnet. And there are 1.5 Tesla magnets in the hospital. And we're soon to get a 3 Tesla magnet in the hospital as well. And all that means, all the Teslas is the magnetic field strength, which is how tight you stretch the string on the piano. And yeah, 3 Teslas, if you have 3 Teslas, yeah, you know, that's $300,000, but 1.5 Tesla, that's still pretty good. I'll still take a Tesla. So how do we use this to make a picture? So again, we stretch the water with a big magnetic field. We stretch the water differently depending on where it is. We bang on it with the FM radio. We listen for it ringing, and we find out where it is. So, let's just get a picture of what's going on here. So this is a picture from the side. You can see this is the buttocks here. This is the rectum, penis, scrotum. This is the bladder. And then this is, of course, what we're interested in here today, which is the prostate gland. Right there. So what does that look like on an MRI? Here's the map that we make on an MRI. And again, we have the same thing. Here's the tailbone, here's the tailbone, here's the rectum, here's the rectum. This is just your front of your pelvic bone here. This is your urinary bladder, lots of white in it because it has lots of water. This is the bladder here. And then this is the prostate gland. So that's an MRI of the prostate. I'm not going to teach you how to do the MRI of the prostate, but I thought it would be useful to have a couple of pictures. All right. Then what we often do is have a look. This is a look from the side. We often slice people sort of horizontally. And I do want to show you one picture of a prostate cancer on an MRI. Just to show you that, why it made you go to work, basically. There's the prostate gland. There's the prostate gland. This is now sliced horizontally. This is the rectum. You can see this white area here. Those are normal glands in your prostate. You can see it's not symmetric. Normally, most things in the body are pretty symmetric. Faces are pretty symmetric. Two arms. Prostate gland is no different. It's pretty symmetric, usually. There's a big nodule, a blob. And here it is here. We ring the protons or the water molecules differently. So here it's light, here it's dark. That's a prostate. And here's the rectum. And you can see why a digital rectal exam is so useful. If you put a finger up here, this is the rectum, and you have a finger up there, you can feel this as a hard nodule. And the problem is sometimes the nodules are up here and you can't feel them. So, what is prostate MRI good for? In certain patients, as I mentioned, it's useful for finding the prostate cancer that you suspect. It's useful for helping the biopsy for suspected prostate cancer. Useful for finding how far prostate cancer has spread outside of the prostate gland. As I mentioned, with the watchful waiting, or what we technically it's called active surveillance, I think MRI has a lot of promise in the very near future, and even now people are using it to see if things that look like not so bad players become bad players and have to be treated. And guiding treatment, this is only being done sort of experimentally now, but I expect it to come about as a more of a mainstream thing fairly quickly. So, let's go over a few of these things. Finding cancer. This is the big study that came up last month. Again, as I mentioned, I'm just going to repeat it because it's something I often repeat because it's so bizarre to me. The prostate gland is the only organ in the human body you randomly biopsy looking for cancer. So this was a big study that looked at people, men who had suspected prostate cancer. So they had something they found in the digital rectal exam where the PSA was up. And they compared randomly biopsying the gland to getting an MRI and only biopsying what looked suspicious. So had a few hundred people get random biopsies, a few hundred people get an MRI and specific biopsies. It turned out the MRI with the directed biopsy found two times as many of the important cancers. It found less of the absolutely really unimportant ones. And some people, as you know, who have elevated PSA or have something found on a digital rectal exam, they don't have prostate cancer. And so those people go through a big random biopsy of the prostate gland where you can possibly get infection or bleeding, and they don't have the cancer. So the MRI allowed a quarter to a third of men to not have to get a prostate biopsy. Probably not as relevant to people here who are survivors, but you know, to the population at large. So the other thing we can do is guide the biopsy. So that's when we find that on the MRI, instead of randomly biopsying the gland, we biopsy the particular spot we're interested in, the worrisome spot. And we do this, actually set up a program here. So what we do is we have our technologist, and I'm the doctor, and we have a probe that has a little biopsy needle, and we have our patient. And we take the MRI, and we take the ultrasound image, and we glue them together. Because you can't biopsy well in the magnetic field. It's hard. It's possible. It's very, very difficult. But it's easy to biopsy with ultrasound. So there's our probe. And this is a little GPS device that tells where the probe is in relation to the prostate. And it shows up here. So I'll just show you. This is another horizontal slice. This is your pelvic, your pubic bone. This is the rectum. Here's a prostate. This patient had nothing found on the digital rectal exam. They had an elevated PSA. They had they went for random biopsies twice. They biopsied the whole gland. Nothing came back. But the PSA kept going. And the reason for that is, again, I don't expect people to be radiologists, but there's a gland here. There's a big blob here. I hope you can appreciate that. Big dark blob, and that's prostate cancer. But it's really far forward, and when they do the biopsy, as you know if you've had one, they biopsy from the rectum. So they can't always get all that way forward unless they know there's definitely something there, and they have to go that far forward. So again, this patient, nothing on the digital rectal exam, fingers here, the cancer's way up here. PSA keeps going out, initial sets of biopsies are negative, but the urologist is still very suspicious. Do the MRI, we find the cancer. This is the rectum. And there's a cancer again. And so now what we do is we take an ultrasound image, and this probably just looks like a big snowstorm to you. It did to me for the first year of my training too, but you can see the cancer here on this one, but you can see it better on the MRI. This is an ultrasound. And what we do, I'll show you, is we glue these together, we can do the biopsy, you'll see a needle coming here, biopsy this cancer, knowing where it is on the MRI, but using ultrasound. This is ultrasound, and this is MRI. The MRI was done months before. The ultrasound is happening right now. If I play this, what is it going to play? Well, if I could point, it would show, you can actually see the needle tracks here. So that's one, another thing is good. The watchful waiting or active surveillance. Again, this is for lower risk cancers. Some of these will not progress quickly. And as you probably know, some treatments for prostate cancer have significant possible side effects, urinary and sexual side effects. And so you don't necessarily want to go through a big treatment if they're not going to progress. On the other hand, if they're going to progress, you want to get on with the treatment. And that's the dilemma. And so in the past, we've looked at following with the digital rectal exam, doing repeat biopsies, which can be dangerous, or following the hand following. The plan, or the hope in the near future, is that we will instead use MRI to watch these periodically and see if they progress. Right now, we're not quite there in terms of the evidence from the big studies showing this definitely works, but we're hopeful that it will. I'm fairly confident. And only treat it if it progresses significantly. Again, this is not for all cancers. This is for some of the lower-risk cancers. And in the future, as I mentioned, the promise of guiding treatment using an MRI, getting the MRI, finding out where the cancer is, instead of taking out the entire prostate in a radical prostatectomy, or treating the entire prostate with radiation, only treating the area that has the cancer, which is what we do in a lot of other organs in the body. And there's different ways that might happen. Robotic surgery, I've had a lot of people have heard about that. I don't think we have it here on the island yet. They have the robot's called Da Vinci, and it has you can connect it to imaging, and it will robotically take out only a certain part of the gland, the prostate, the tumor. Other treatment, internal radiation therapy, brachytherapy, you may be able to guide where that therapy happens with the MRI. And then there's a new treatment. Has anyone heard of HIFU? So there's a treatment called high intensity focused ultrasound. Still basically experimental. I mean, it's not experimental in the sense that it's used on just testing on animals. Or, you know, it's being done, not here in town, and not in, I don't believe in Vancouver, though someone might be able to correct me, I think just in Toronto. I could be wrong with that. Where you use high intensity focused ultrasound to, and what that means, you take sound waves and you focus them with a lens, a sound lens, and you heat up the tissue with the ultrasound, you heat up the tumor. But of course, to do that, you need to know where the tumor is. And so if you get the MRI, find where the tumor is, and then use the ultrasound to, in conjunction with the MRI information, to burn the tumor. So that's what it, basically, the summary is, prostate MRI is not the be-all and end-all. It's not an panacea. It's a new and important tool. It's an up-and-comer. And it already is a game changer for certain things, and I think it will be for other things. And I'm not sure how applicable this is to everyone in the room, but that's where it is. I'm happy to take any questions you might have.
My urologist had me do a bone scan as well.
Right.
He said surgery, you see the cancer is spread in the bones.
Right.
I'm trying to figure out why they still do the digital examination. Surgically.
Right.
There's nothing there. What are they
looking for? Okay, the question is sort of two questions really, if I can paraphrase. One is what tests are used to look if prostate cancer is spread outside the prostate or has recurred in the area. And number two, why would they do a digital rectal exam afterwards if the prostate gland's already gone? Is that? So the first one is, there's different places prostate cancer can spread, and there's different ways to look at those different areas. So prostate cancer can spread immediately outside of the prostate. It can leave the prostate and go into your seminal vesicles, your bladder, your rectum, the lymph nodes right around your prostate. And the best way to look at that is MRI, and to some extent the digital rectal exam. Prostate cancer can go to the bones. It's a commonplace for it to go. The best way to look for that is a bone scan. Prostate cancer can go to other lymph nodes in your abdomen, can sometimes go to your lungs, can go to your liver. The best way to look for that is a CAT scan or an MRI. So depending on what your urologist or oncologist is suspecting, they might use one or all of those tests. The second question about why would you do a digital exam if it's been taken out, if there's what's called local recurrence, so there's some cells left over in the area and they come back and grow, you might be able to feel that. That's a good question.
Do you have any comments to make on accuracy of detection of problem cancer with the MRI?
So there's been lots of studies on that. It's always getting better. We say it has a very, very high, the technical term is that it has a high negative predictive value, which means if we say we don't see a worrisome cancer, there is a very high likelihood there is not. Doesn't mean you might still not get a follow-up PSA and a recheck. The negative predictive value is a little less good. The positive predictive value is a little less good. So if we say there's a cancer there, occasionally we're wrong. And sometimes we're equivocal. But the negative predictive value, so in terms of saying there's nothing there, in studies it's as high as 90 to 100%. And we're getting there. There are some studies show it's actually pretty much 100%. Not all studies show it. So if you say there's no cancer, there's no cancer. I wouldn't promise that. I would say it's more like 95%. Maybe there's still 120. But if we say there's a worrisome nodule, there's still a chance we'll biopsy and it's nothing.
Right. But that's what you would find if you found a positive result, then a guided biopsy would be.
Usually,
you find out the accuracy.
Yeah, so right now, that's actually a good question. What happens in Victoria when you get a positive result? So we're still building our program up. So right now, if you get a positive result on an MRI, we give a recommendation to the urologist. And the urologist might choose to use some other information and change our recommendation. And that's fine. We work very closely with all the urologists. We all know each other by name. We've got each other on speed dial and cell phone. And so right now, if it's a medium-sized to small nodule, you will probably get sent to get one of our directed biopsies. If it's a big nodule, just because of resource limitations right now, you probably still get the random biopsy. I think you're next. No? Okay, sorry.
What are the side effects of an MRI?
So actually, that's a very good question. So who can have an MRI and who can't have an MRI? And there's a few different side effects. So one, first thing I'll say, there's no dangerous radiation like there is with a CAT scan. Although a CT scan, it's really not that much radiation. There are some people who can't get an MRI if you have certain cardiac implants, although we're actually working around that pretty well now. But many people with pacemakers and defibrillators. Does anyone here have a pacemaker or defibrillator? Don't tell me, you don't have to start anyway. But some of those patients can't have it, although we're working so that they can with some new information. If you have an allergy to the dye we use, we don't have to use the dye. And in fact, in the private MRI here, they don't use the dye. But it gives you a little bit of additional information. But you could possibly have an allergic reaction to that. But probably the most common side effect to an MRI is just claustrophobia. The magnet, I think there were a bunch of people who have been in the magnet. It's pretty close quarters. It's pretty confined. And then there's a lot of big noises that are being made by the magnet. And that's probably the most common side effect is some people get too much claustrophobia and they can't deal with it.
How long does the MRI take?
So a prostate MRI takes, the actual MRI itself probably takes only about 15 to 20 minutes. But then there's a little bit of a setup, and then there's a little bit of a getting you out of the machine too. But it's about.
So you could be confined for 15 minutes.
If we were really, we book them for half an hour, but you're not in there for that.
The MRI machine, you know, so they might be a big donor, but I guess it's just for MRIs, universal for anywhere in the body, but when you're putting it on the prostate, you're able to just carve it and only sort of stretch the water molecules in the prostate. You're not stretching water molecules.
That's right. It's a good question. I'll remember to repeat this one. The question was, how do you just target the specific, the specific gland? And there's two ways to do it. There's two ways we do that. One, we only stretch them in a particular part of the body, and we have special ways to do that. And the other one is the antenna we use to listen, either the one that goes up the back end, which we haven't really been using here too much, or the surface, what we call the surface antenna, which is just a little, almost like a blanket. And we would just put that over sort of your pelvis. And so we only stretch the water fat molecules in that area, and then we only listen in that area.
Much difference in the different types of antenna?
Yeah, very much.
I mean, as regards accuracy.
Yeah, so there is. There is. They're better and worse in different ways. Most people would say that the endorectal coil is a little bit better, but there are certain aspects that aren't actually better for it. And I'm just going to be quite honest with you here. Because we are somewhat resource limited, and we want to get to as many patients as we can and not have a waiting list that's 2 years long. The surface coil is perfectly adequate. It only sacrifices a tiny bit, and in a couple of ways it's a little bit better, but it allows us to get more patients through. And that's just the fact of the matter. And sorry, I forgot to give the question at the end. I told you I'd forget. I think back in the day.
Yeah, what's recommended for MRI? What is the average wait time?
So it's very much. Oh, sorry. What is the average wait time for an MRI? And what's recommended?
Well, I mean, if you're going to have an MRI, what is the average wait time?
Yeah, so the average wait time for a prostate MRI is probably a couple few months. Okay. That being said, that's more for the MRI, the kind of MRI where we're looking to diagnose the prostate cancer. If it's to what we call stage the prostate cancer, to see if it's come outside the gland, I've instructed our staff, and if this doesn't happen, the urologist will usually call me and remind me that those ones should probably be done a bit faster, and we'll try to get them in a little bit faster.
When I had an MRI not long back, they put you in, put the blanket over you. I asked him what the blanket was for. He said it was lead to protect you. So anyway, I didn't argue, I just carried on. Then they pull you out and inject fluid into you. What is that for? Why can't that be done before you go in?
That's a great question. So there's two questions there. One, when you, this was a prostate MRI, wasn't it? So you go in for a prostate MRI and there's a blanket on top of you.
Yeah.
First question is, what is that? The second question is, they inject dye into you, but it's done in the middle of the procedure. Why can't they just do it at the beginning? Why do they have to take you in?
Yeah, because you have to come out.
That's right. So the first question is,
I don't know
who told you it was lead. That is actually the FM antenna that picks up the ringing from your prostate. That's what that blanket is. The second question is the dye we inject. So in the private magnets in town, they don't inject the dye. In the hospital, we do inject the dye. And it gives you a little bit of additional information. So what happens is prostate cancer recruits blood vessels. So it sends out signals that tell the body to grow abnormal blood vessels into the tumor to to supply it and help it grow. And what the dye does is the dye goes into those abnormal blood vessels and the prostate cancer lights up. It only actually gives us a little bit of extra information, but it does give us extra information enough that at the hospital here, we feel it's useful enough that we do it. But the thing is, the reason you can't have it at the beginning is because we have to inject the dye and watch it, actually like a video. We inject the dye and we watch it go through the prostate. And then in the prostate cancers, it'll go there first before the rest of it. And that's why you have to be pulled out for it. And we inject it and then watch it.
So why doesn't the private do that?
So it's a good question. There's two good reasons. One is that, the question was why doesn't the private magnet use the intravenous dye? And it's a fair question. One, it's very probable that in the next set of guidelines that comes out from the big organization that guides prostate MRI, they won't be recommending it, the intravenous dye anymore. So it's probably not going to be used anymore. Not sure about that yet. The second one is the private magnet is a 3 Tesla magnet. It's a higher magnetic field. So the other, what we call sequences, the other pictures are so much better that you probably don't need to use it. The question is when we get the 3 Tesla, the stronger magnet at the hospital, if we'll continue using the X-ray dye or not. To be honest with you, those are uncomfortable questions for me because you're asking me why things are done differently in different places. And sometimes it's just a practical reason, and I'll be straight up. When you ask me them, I'll tell you the answer. But I think both approaches are entirely reasonable, especially since it's a higher signal, higher magnetic field strength, not giving the X-ray dye as far.
After treatment and you have recurrence of prostate cancer, in other words, the PSA started to climb back up, is there any stage where the MRI should come in to see what's happening?
So the question was if you've had a prostatectomy or treatment, some kind of treatment, or radiation, prostatectomy, radiation, or hormonal, and you're monitoring the PSA, and the PSA comes up, is there a point at which you should get an MRI? And that is an open question. That's a future question. I can't answer that, because the studies, the tests, haven't been done. And so right now, we do occasionally do MRIs, when the urologist or the oncologist ask for them for that reason, and we interpret them the best we can, but we're kind of flying a little bit in the dark for that particular reason, because the big studies looking at 1,000 patients with that reason and looking what the MRI shows and what happens, it hasn't been done yet. We do our best when we get that question, and I can almost guarantee that 5 years from now there'll be an answer to that question. Because again, this is a new area, but right now there's no answer to that question. Sorry. And I think we have you in the back.
Yeah, the question I have is the probability of a big problem with cancer is prostate cancer is if it's contained or it's not contained. And there's 3 ways of testing for that. That they use, one's MRI, and one is a
CT scan.
Can you comment on what contained means? Because I had all 3 tests, and all 3 tests said it's not contained. So it is contained, and my surgeon says there's 40% chance when they cut me open that it probably did escape. So, can you clarify anything of that?
Sure.
These are all knowledgeable people, so it's not like one's wrong and one's right. So, it's probably some definition of what's contained.
Yeah, so the question is, I think there's a few questions there. One is, what does cancer contained to the prostate mean?
Yeah.
Two is, what tests are used to see if it's not contained to the prostate or it is? And three is, how come some people will say there's still a chance it's outside of your prostate, even though those tests say it isn't? I think that's fair enough, right? So to go to the first question, what is not contained to the prostate? And there's basically two ways it cannot be contained to the prostate. One, the tumor that's in your prostate can grow outside of, just grow bigger and start invading structures outside of your prostate, like your rectum, which you saw is right next to it, or your bladder, as I mentioned. So that's one way. That's called direct extension, if you will. It's just growth into the adjacent things. The other way is metastatic spread, where it gets into your blood vessels and spreads around the body. So those are the two ways. And that's called distant spread. There's local invasion and there's distant spread. Okay. So that's what outside of the prostate means. And they mean a little bit different things. And it's a better question for a urologist in terms of how they treat them than it is for me. That's question one. Question two is, what do we use to look if it's outside the prostate and how good is it? So again, the three tests we use to look at if it's outside the prostate, MRI will tell you if it's immediately, locally invaded outside the prostate, just grown into something next to the prostate. A bone scan will tell you if it's gone to the bone. And a CAT scan will tell you if it's gone to the lung or the liver. The bone scan is very good. Again, no test is 100%. There's no panacea, there's no perfect test. A bone scan is very close to 100%. About 100%. An MRI, if we say it's definitely negative, it's not outside the gland, it's very, very good, not quite 100%. And then a CAT scan to look at the lymph nodes and the liver and the chest isn't quite as good as excluding that. So that's how good those tests are. Now, in terms of how can they all be negative, but someone still tell you that there's a chance it's spread? It's probably a different, based on a statistical thing, that if you have a certain tumor that has certain findings on your biopsy, certain Gleason score, certain PSA level, there's a statistical probability that it's outside the prostate, even though all of those tests say it isn't. There's always a small chance.
Okay, look, when I run those regression models they got, I think they call them Mendel, there's a parking table and there's three different tables to look at. Which of those spreads is...
I'm not familiar with those tables. I thought we'd answer that for you. That's a better question for an oncologist or your oncologist. Yes?
Well, just kind of follow up to this question. You mentioned three other tests to see if it's spread. I mean, would there be like a blood test that would show white blood cells? Isn't there some other tests, like blood tests that would show whether cancer, if you're worried that it's spread, but it doesn't show that it's in the bones, liver, anything? I mean, if you have something there, wouldn't some sort of blood test
show? So the question is there a blood test that shows that there's been spread or recurrence? And the only answer to that, and again, this is probably a better question for a urologist, but PSA, as you know, it's not a perfect test, but that is the test you're talking about. Are people working on other tests? Definitely. But nothing's, to my knowledge, is being used regularly now. Yes?
I had a CAT scan at 4:30 on Friday afternoon, and the urologist called me Sunday at 9 o'clock in the morning with the results. So they must be just putting that there on the computer and sending it off. Very quick results.
So we tried, the comment was that the CT scan gets read pretty quickly. We try to do the technical term is contemporaneous reporting. We try to make it so things are read the same day. They're not always. Sometimes it's a couple of days. Sometimes it's even longer. But we do our best to read it.
This was in Nova Scotia.
What was it, Nova Scotia? Are you from Nova Scotia? Oh, okay, so am I.
In fact, you're not there tonight.
Yes.
Yeah, I just had a comment. There was a show on Discovery a couple of months ago where they were using dogs to test and find prostate cancer. And it was amazing because they would just smell a person and they would, it was quite a long training process that they, and they're trying to find out how the dog knows that, so they can replicate it chemically as a real test.
Yeah, so the comment was that there was a study, so was it Discovery Channel?
Yeah, it was on
Discovery. Saw on Discovery Channel. I haven't seen it, so I'll tell you when I go home, I'm going to look for it.
Yeah.
But where dogs could smell prostate cancer. And I don't know anything about that. I don't know the study. I don't know how good it is. Or, but I do know that dogs have an unbelievably good sense of smell.
There was a show on White Coat Black Art. It's available in podcast approximately last November, where it had a similar essay on that matter, where the dogs were trained up to detect certain types of cancer.
Yeah, I've heard that. Like, I don't think I've ever seen one of the studies or seen one of the shows, but I know dogs are pretty amazing.
Just a word. One of the gentlemen was talking about the accessibility to an MRI. I'm fairly new to this. Started in September last year. Went to my first visit with the urologist, and he put two positions up. He said, I can go in, do a biopsy, and if it's suitable, we can have it done as an MRI later. Or you can go to the private place out at Save On Food, and I can do my biopsy on that. The difference is $995. I chose for the $995. When it was all over, about a week later, 8 biopsies were done. He made a point of saying, thank you for doing it, because I knew exactly where to position the biopsies.
So yeah, the comment was that you were given an option of just going straight to biopsy or getting an MRI before the biopsy.
Correct.
And your urologist commented that it allowed him or her to direct it better. And that's the whole point of the program. And we work very closely with the whole urologist and with the oncologist as well.
Yeah.
And we go back and forth, and we actually have we have a meeting scheduled in March to go over how things are going. We're putting on a meeting to teach other radiologists and urologists about this. We're putting it on in Vancouver in May, and that's what we're hoping for. And the real problem is sometimes people go for biopsy after biopsy after biopsy, and they don't find anything, but the PSA keeps going up. So the hope is, and nothing's perfect, but the hope is if you do an MRI, it'll show. Yeah. There's nothing worrisome, don't know why the PSA is up, nothing worrisome. Or there is this nodule, and it's in this exact place, please biopsy that.
Can nodules be,
No, it's correct. Okay.
Can nodules be detected outside of the prostate and treated directly by radiation or what's the scope of it?
Nodules, you mean prostate cancer nodules?
Yes. Let's say you've got a recurrent, something's a nodule.
Oh, recurrent outside. So that's, can they be detected? Yes, they can. Various ways, CAT scan, MRI, digital rectal exam. Can they be treated specifically? You would have to talk to a radiation oncologist. I'm not 100% sure what they're doing for that right now. And I don't want to mislead you on that. That's not my exact area. But can they be detected? Yes, they can.
I was just going to say, so you're saying that the MRI can find the cancer in the prostate, right? I had one set of biopsies, nothing wrong, nothing there. The next set of biopsies, I went to Vancouver with that screening machine that they have there, which you showed, and they sent a DVD over to them, and they had that playing at the same time. They found 17, yet I was told 2 months before, there's nothing wrong. So, having suffered the pain of two different attempts to do the biopsies, I would think that's brilliant. I wish I had had that.
So again, the comment was, you had an initial set of biopsies if nothing was on.
He said then, nothing, but when I went to Vancouver, which was a teaching hospital, I didn't know until I walked in the room. I was the guinea pig, I was the first one. And when they were, taking out the core, the second time it sounded like a metal stapler going through my body. It was so loud, it was unbelievable. And what I found was they went into the gland further than some urologists in the city that were doing it by hand. You were just on a couch, give her a local. And that's not good enough. You know, it doesn't go into the actual gland.
So the comment, like, I think I mentioned the comment, but the urologists here are very good when they do their biopsies. They're extremely good, as are we. But there's a good point in what you said, though. One is that randomly biopsying something without having a direction to go, it works, but it's not as good as knowing where you're going. And the other point is, you said maybe you didn't get in far enough. That is something that's well known, that the cancers that are way far forward, further away from your rectum, they're a bit harder to diagnose because you have to get further out to get them.
And also, I was told that he was the only urologist in the city of Victoria that didn't do biopsies in a hospital. And all of a sudden, I saw an orange light round me. The anaesthetic had gone into me. And apart from wanting to be sick there and then, he was rushing. And he said to me, "Do you understand French?" I said, "No." And then his conversation with the nurse, you know, I didn't understand it, but I knew there was something wrong. And I wouldn't, I mean, why would you do an operation like that, not in a hospital?
I'm actually not sure what you'd have to talk to the urologist about that. I'm not
no,
sure.
No, he's retired now. Thank you.
If you have a MRI, and you detect cancer and you fuse it with an ultrasound, are there areas of the prostate that you can't actually biopsy?
No, there's not. There's ones that are much more difficult. And so the question is, if you have an MRI and it shows a suspicious lesion, and we do this fusion biopsy with the two screens where we paste the MRI to the ultrasound, are there areas that we can't get to? There's not, but some are harder to get to. If the nodule is very, very small, we will mention that it's a very small nodule, and we might, even if it's negative, we might recommend a follow-up MRI. And then some that are really high up near the bladder, way low down, there might be it'd be more difficult to get to. We might have to do more samples. And there might be I don't know if this is a fact, but speculating, there might be a slightly increased risk of some complications like bleeding or infection.
Just one quick question. Sure. Regarding fusing MRI and ultrasound, can you do that with a private MRI?
Yeah. So yeah, you can take the, and we do all the time, they get sent to us. They get sent to us on a disc, and we load them up, and we fuse them together.
So I think we're going to have to close.
Okay.
Dr. has another commitment. So I want to thank him very much. It's good to know there's advances happening all the time, and this sounds like a terrific new tool, and I'm sure most of us here would love to see it used more in the future, but we also understand resources are scarce. So thank you very much.